And you had peace from God our Father and the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, be met. The Word of God that we wish to contemplate for this morning is found recorded for us in Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. Allow me to highlight for you verses 1 through 2. In those days, John the Baptist came, preaching in the desert of Judea and saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." That's far God's work. That's you and I can see with prayer. Gracious and merciful Father, we come to you and give you thanks for the precious gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. He is our heart and core. He is what we are all about, dear Lord. He is the one for whom we now need to be preparing our hearts for when he comes again. Prepare us through the gospel, dear Lord. Prepare us for Jesus. Amen. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Those are the words of John the Baptist that have come down to us. And I would ask this question of you this morning. How would you classify those words? In truth, those are not words that are hard to understand. And as you look at them, you can see that they are not words that are really harsh or demanding. In fact, they are rather simple words. But they are words that I think you will agree that are words of warning. And that's how we would classify those words, words of warning. Unfortunately, I think we, like many in the days of John, have a habit of taking warnings a little too lightly. We are warned that speeding will get us a ticket, yet it always seems that when you're pulled over, it's such a surprise when you see the flashing lights and you get pulled over, and many of us become angry with that policeman because, and this is our attitude, "I wasn't going as fast as the other cars." Yet that's not the point. The warning of the law says that if you speed, you can get a ticket. It doesn't say that you have to be the fastest on the road at that particular time. Just that if you speed, you can get a ticket. For years, the Surgeon General has seen to it that every packet of cigarettes carries a warning. And those warnings, those words of warning, tell us on those cigarettes that cigarette smoking will cause cancer. And yet as I look around at the world, and I see the vast number of smokers, it becomes clear that there are so many people who don't think that warning is meant for them. And it seems that that attitude that people have towards cigarettes and what they do is the exact warning that we have, or the exact attitude we have toward many of the other warnings found in our lives. If you have kids or grandkids, you are warned and warned to be careful of the many poisonous substances that are now found in our modern households today. And today's poisons are very deceptive because they have nice smells and all that stuff. We're supposed to have cupboard locks. We're supposed to use those special caps. You know the caps I'm talking about that takes an engineer to figure out how to get them off. And we're supposed to have yucky stickers in place. But you know what? I ran a quick check on the internet, and I learned very quickly that there are some 1.3 million cases a year of those 19 and younger who are poisoned just by the medicines we have in our households. By the medicines. And you go, wow. And on average, the Poison Control Center of our country gets 3 million calls a year seeking help with poisonings. Yep, we get warned. We hear the warnings, but somehow we think that it's about someone else. We think, oh, it would never be a problem for us. Now, what I find fascinating is that some warnings we respond to, I guess we think those warnings are immediate or something like that. Let a fire alarm go off, and we tend to pay attention. Or perhaps it might be a tornado warning or a burglar alarm. Oh, and then your attention is right on. These types of warnings we have a tendency to respond to as good warnings, maybe immediate warnings, but all too often, the warnings that we find in our life, well, we ignore them. That's our human nature. And even in the midst of the church, warnings are cast aside. The Word of God is presented. Now, I'll be more specific. More specifically, it's the law of God that is presented, and we are warned that our sins could lead to damnation. And while we're sitting here in church, we all feel bad that we're such sinners. And yet, we walk out of church, and sometimes before we even get to our cars, we are already rather thoughtlessly and comfortably slipping back into those pet sins of ours, as if what we heard in God's Word isn't that big a deal. And I have to say, seriously, many of us have a problem with warnings, especially some of the warnings that are found in God's Word. The text that is before us is one that tells us about a man and his message of warning. And that man is John the Baptist. John is clearly labeled as the forerunner of the Christ. So I'll let you and I take a look at this man and his work. And our theme will be very simple. It will be John, the early warning prophet. Now, as you look at this text, we can see that John was indeed a man who was different than most. And perhaps that was part of the appeal of John, this difference that he had, that appeal that caused so many to glout and to listen to what John had to say. Now, remember, John is actually born as a member of the Jewish priesthood. No doubt John had the finest training, and he was schooled in the ways of the priestly profession, just as his father had been, and just as so many others had been. And yet, John is different. And clearly, by the time John is found preaching in the wilderness, it's very clear that John is no longer living like the majority of the people of his time. And it makes you want to ask, what are some of the other differences? So, for instance, although Matthew doesn't mention this, we find this mentioned in the Gospel of Luke, that John was a Nazarene for life. Did you know that there are only two others found in Scripture who have that designation, a Nazarene for life? Samuel the prophet. Remember that little boy? He was a Nazarene for life. Samson, that strong man, judge of God, he was a Nazarene for life. Nazarenes were not to have any strong drink. Nazarenes were not permitted to eat or drink anything that was made from the fruit of the vine or anything that came from the grape. And top all of that off with the fact that the Nazarene was also not to have a haircut. Yeah, and all of that was to simply make clear that the Nazarene was a servant of the Lord God, and the Nazarene, therefore, was different from everyone else. There are other differences found in John. So the other thing about John that was different was that John is a prophet of the Lord. Even at the announcement of his birth to his father by the angel Gabriel, we hear these words, and these are the words of Gabriel. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth. Many of the people of Israel will he bring back to the Lord their God, and he will go out before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the fathers to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. I think those words formed much of the life of John. So, for instance, when we find John in the wilderness carrying out his mission as this forerunner of the Christ, do you note that John is dressed just like Elijah used to dress? And no doubt that was brought about by something the Holy Spirit did with John. The other thing, interesting thing about John is his diet. Locusts and wild honey. Locusts, grasshoppers. He didn't eat the normal food of the day. He didn't take and use the official food allotted to a man of the house of Levi, which is what he was. And I think somehow that John's diet was a visual message to the people who came out to see him. We don't necessarily understand John's diet. And clearly, all of this came together because Matthew reports that John was preaching repentance and that people from all over the land headed out to see and hear John. Yeah, even the religious officials went out to see and to hear. And why not? For over 400 years, the Lord has not sent a prophet to his people. The Lord has been absolutely silent for 400 years, which is quite a contrast to the first 1,000 years of his dealing with the Jewish people. And now, here is John. Do you recognize that John is the connecting link between the Old and the New Testaments? See, the Old Testament is that part of God's history that tells us of the coming Savior and what that Savior would do for them. That's really the purpose and intent of the Old Testament. The New Testament is that part of history where God fulfills all of the Old Testament promises. And I want you to think about John for a moment, because you go, yep. John brings together the Old and the New Testament. See, John was the last prophet of messianic promise. He was pointing to the Savior who would come. Still making prophecies of the Savior to come. And John was also the first who began to fulfill the promises of the Old Testament. Matthew, for instance, very accurately reports of John in accord with the words of Isaiah that John was fulfilling these words. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him. You see, John was indeed special. Oh, we could say John was different because he was the prophet. He was the forerunner of the Christ. And surely, this prophet, this forerunner, he is a prophet that you and I should indeed consider. Now, as I said before, the message of John was really very simple, wasn't it? Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Please note that first word. Repent is a word that means change your mind. Now, just what do religious people have to change their mind about? Well, please remember that John's words are directed to the Jewish people of his day. They were a people who had lost sight of their religion. They were a people who had misdirected their hearts from the truth of God's salvation and the promises of his Messiah. To the Jewish people, the way of the Lord was obscure, and the path of salvation had become crooked because they had trouble following it. You might say that these people were looking in the wrong way for their hope and their comfort. And isn't that sad? Because in truth, the way of the Lord, in other words, that road from sin to salvation, the way of the Lord is laid out throughout the Old Testament, and I think it's clear. By the time of Jesus, this was no longer a well-marked out lesson of God because they had so twisted and contorted Scripture. And even the people in the pews or the people in the churches were affected. So people, through their own doubts, people, through their unbelief, people, through their self-righteousness, had lost the true path of God. And they simply began to lay out their own path, their own ways into heaven. And those human ways always, always lead to the wrong place. So rightly, John's cry was, repent. Change your mind about following your own path. Return to God and his word. Let God show you the path, and that path will be clear. It will be a path that is familiar. It will be a path that is well marked out. It will be a path that will lead you straight to the kingdom of heaven. I think the call is clear. Repent. Return to God. And I think we would all agree the call is urgent because, to be honest with you, I think these words are as urgent today as they were in the days of John because not much has changed. People today are still trying to make their own path to heaven rather than follow God's path and God's word. Now, of course, you and I can see the urgency of John's words in that next phrase, can't we? For the kingdom of heaven is near. I want you to just think about what John is saying there. For John, he was telling the people of his day of the imminent fact that the Christ of God was soon to be revealed. John was looking for it. John was preaching about it. John was the forerunner. That was his job. He was the forerunner of Jesus. He was there to prepare people for the fact that the Messiah had arrived and to make sure that the people heard and believed and turned to the Messiah as their hope and comfort when this Messiah was fully revealed. You see, these words are telling. These words are telling us that what was going on was a now thing. Now, I have to tell you that John was not at all easy on the people who came to him. John was, in essence, a preacher of the law. Oh, he had gospel, but John was, in essence, a preacher of the law. Because of what John said, and I think because of the way he said it and the circumstances that surrounded his preaching, we hear this. People went out to him from Jerusalem and all Judea and the whole region of the Jordan, confessing their sins. They were baptized by him in the Jordan River. And there's the thing that's startling. People were confessing sin. These were Jewish people who had been taught by their religious leaders that as the special people of God, they were above sin. This was a group of people who, by and large, believed, hey, I'm okay, you're okay, we're all okay. What's the problem here? They believed that they were loved of God simply because of who and what they were, the descendants of Abraham. But I want you to note that John has them repenting. John has them confessing sins and even getting baptized as a sign of their repentance. Oh, and when the religious leaders came out, when those religious leaders who came out, you see, those people who had misled the common people with their false hope and promises, oh, John was not easy on them at all. Our text reveals what he said to them. You brood of vipers. Who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And do not think you can say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father. I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees. And every tree that does not produce fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. You recognize the intensity of those words. And all I'm going to say here is clearly, John has been given insight into the heart of these leaders through the Holy Spirit that was in him. And make no mistake, John is clearly telling them that without true faith in God, and that's what he's telling them, they don't have true faith in God. But John is telling them, without true faith in God, without evidence of that faith, by true repentance, they were headed for eternal hell. And as I contemplate that, as I contemplate how John preached such forceful law for the good of souls, I'm led to think how our modern church and how many church bodies today have shied away from talking about sin or shied away from pointing out evil or even their attitude when it comes down to the church. Their attitude is oftentimes, well, in the church, when you listen to the pastor, you should only hear good, positive, upbeat things that will help you in your life. And honestly, by today's standards, John would have been told he's a horrid preacher. And yet you need to grasp, John was preparing hearts. And I want you to think of it this way, and I think all of us here will get this because we're from a rural community. Don't plant until you prepare the field for the seed. And all of us, if you understand God's word, you recognize that's what the law does. The law prepares the field for the seed. The law prepares hearts for Christ. And yes, John did indeed point to Jesus. He says of him, I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me will come one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I'm not fit to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand. He will clear his threshing floor, gathering his wheat into the barn and burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire. But true, John does prepare for Jesus. John tells people he's coming, and don't you find it interesting how he describes Jesus, especially here? I mean, we also understand he calls Jesus the Lamb of God, takes away the sin of the world. But in this particular section, he describes Jesus how? Jesus is the one who comes and he gathers the wheat, and he burns the chaff. And you recognize that's the very same message that Jesus himself taught. Mark 16:16. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. Whoever does not believe will be condemned. Dear people, it's a very simple message in every way, isn't it? And I think John's message is still a very worthy one. Because we are still a people who need to repent, a people who need to turn to God and confess our sins, because we do have sins. And those sins separate us from God in every way. But I'm also here to tell you that God is a game changer. A game changer. Because God sent us a Savior. I get this. Because of Jesus. Just because Jesus died for all of our sins and rose again from the dead, we have this hope. This awesome, sure and certain confidence of God's eternal gift of heaven. All God wants us to do is believe in Jesus. Because believing in Jesus is a life changer. And yeah, Jesus is a life changer. Because faith in Jesus changes us. It does. It makes me hate sin. Makes me desire to live a life pleasing to God, to bring Him glory and honor in everything that I do. That's simply called a life of repentance. And here's the fun thing. The first fruit in keeping with repentance is repentance itself. I think that's almost the first thing every Christian will do. As you come to this grasp of what Jesus has done to you, you will simply be a person who is sorry for your sins. Sorry for offending God. Sorry because we grasp that Jesus had to die for our sins. And he did. And that's when you realize Jesus, he's a life changer. Not because we have to change our lives, but because we can't help but change our lives when we grasp what Jesus has done for us. Jesus has bought us. Jesus has brought us sure and certain eternal life and salvation by grace through faith in what he has done. Yep, John's early warning prophet. And his words still ring out, and they are still true. And his words still point to Jesus. And his words cause us to hope, and they cause us to look to Jesus for his redemption. That work of redemption Jesus has done. And my prayer is simple for you. May God's kingdom of heaven be yours in Jesus, and may you be the wheat gathered into the barn, gathered by Jesus. Amen.